Another couple of seconds here. We'll have 6 o'clock.
Okay.
Yeah.
Literally a couple of seconds, because now it's 6 o'clock. Now calling to order the May 13th, 2021 meeting of the Mashpee Conservation Commission. I would ask that anyone who is not currently engaged in speaking or in their hearing mute their microphones. That having said, is there anyone with business before the commission that is not on the agenda right now?
Nobody has called in or alerted us to anything, topics to talk about off agenda.
Thank you, Drew. Hearing none, I want to bring up one brief thing before I turn this over to Drew for some pre-posted meeting minute items. The one business I have is I'd like to thank both our town manager, Rodney Collins, and selectman Andy Gottlieb, who have agreed to find an alternative location for the pump house for the sewer system that would have been placed within Mashpee River Woodlands there. I appreciate their support in conservation and preservation of our open spaces. That having said, Drew, if you could take over.
Sure. I'm just going to hold off on the meeting minutes because I know we have a pretty lengthy agenda tonight, and I wanted to get to the first pre-post item. That's Meredith Hallinan.
Chadwick.
What's that? Chadwick, I'm sorry.
Chadwick, that's okay. That was my married name.
So I'll hand it over to Meredith, and I've got some images up on the screen that Meredith has given me for this administrative approval request of the commission. And Meredith, I'll just hand it over to you if you want to describe the project that you're looking to do.
All right. It's really not a project. We live on a private road, and you can see in one of the pictures how much water we get. And well, it's facing me. Off to the left, you'll see, off to the right, you'll see a drain. And then you'll see past the drain, you'll see like a culvert. Now that culvert's been there for years and years and years. And over the years, it's gotten really, really wide. So what I've done is I've been trying to shrink it by putting just rocks in it, so all the debris that supposedly washes down will not go into the pond. And also there is, you can see a long line that that washes from dirt and sand, washes down from Seneca and washes down from my street, which is Conanchet. And we are just trying to back that off. It's nothing to do, we're not cutting into the conservation. It's just to the dirt, just before the grass starts. And so that we can redirect the water into the original drain, which is there. The reason you see it dug up in the culvert is because we had a new person that was down the street, and he was fixing cars, and he was washing, God only knows what he was washing down the street, and it was going into the pond. And every time we tried to fix it and put the rocks there, he would take them out and throw them. So unfortunately, for years and years, I haven't fixed it. So this year is what I wanted to do. I'm just digging out the rocks that the people have been driving over to replace them into that culvert so that it will block up again and none of the water will drain down that culvert, but be redirected into the basin there.
Okay, thank you, Meredith. And just so I can kind of give you the setting, and I apologize, I really should have taken a picture of the pond, but this left image here, the embankment, the road shoulder on the left, the pond is just downslope from this area. It's Catakin Pond. This is adjacent to the neighborhood that also abuts John's Pond on the eastern shoreline of John's Pond. So this is a smaller pond. It is not a great pond. It's actually a privately owned pond. And this neighborhood doesn't have an association. And what's happened here, probably the best photo to show you, I'm going to go back up, is here, the top left photo, looking here. This is all just compacted dirt that's come over the years with vehicles driving through and is mounded up and kind of pushed the road shoulder, if you will, further into the road, therefore diverting this runoff, which should be reaching this catch basin right here, past it and over to this swale, which leads down towards the pond. So what they're proposing to do, and what they were doing initially before I notified them of jurisdiction, is cutting away all of this compacted dirt so that the line of stormwater runoff will actually reach its intended target here. Just over the years, all this stuff has been mounded up. Sediment never cleared away. It's a private road. It's not a public road, so DPW doesn't do any maintenance here. From my discussion with Meredith is that they are going to petition ultimately for the road to be taken over by the town, because obviously it needs serious maintenance. This is just a small measure to try and get the water to go to the drain by digging out this compacted soil along the road shoulder. So I decided to have them come in for administrative review. If the commission feels that this requires more substantial permitting, that's your decision. I just wanted to present this to you because these women are taking it upon themselves to improve a road condition, at least temporarily, you know, on behalf of everyone who lives off the road. So I thought I would just provide this opportunity to present it to the commission. It's fairly straightforward. It's just trying to undo years of compaction of soil and gravel and get the water to go where it should here. And then any kind of long-term fixes as far as stormwater runoff and drainage, they're not going to handle any of that. That's going to be someday the town, hopefully, will come in and deal with that larger overriding issue here. So with that, I'll pass it off to the commissioners if you have any questions, comments.
Just one thing, Drew. We were digging out the rocks so that we could replace them back to stop that water from draining down. That's why you see the big muddy hole there. And that's what we wanted. And that culvert has decreased over the years, seeing that we put the rocks there. I've been working on this road for 20 plus years. And, you know, we've asked for help, but the town always says, no, you have to maintain the road. It's a private road. We can't help you. So that's what we've been doing.
Sure, understood. And you know, and I apologize. I didn't touch on that. This culvert area here, it's really more of a swale than a culvert. It's not a culvert. The culvert is a pipe. There's no pipe. So putting in stones here will help to break up the water because it's channelized. You can see heading down towards the pond. Putting stones in there at least is a temporary measure to try and, you know, alleviate that gullying that's happening there. But when you dig this away, looking at the left photo, it really will direct the water in where it's intended to go, and it'll stop going down here, or at least decrease. And then with the stone, So I understand this is a very spit and glue type of approach. I do strongly recommend that, you know, it be the town do take over the road eventually so they can do what really needs to be done here long term. I would say that aside from the, you know, placing rocks in the gully and scraping out dirt, that's all you should be limited to be doing in this area, because anything else really, you know, requires, you know, the DPW and professional, you know, contracting work to deal with that situation long term. This is just a short term fix, and I believe it will work very well in the short term, because it's really just taking a shovel and digging out this back of soil to get the water to go down this drain.
And that's all we were going to do.
Circumnavigating around here and going into this gully instead. So pass it off to the commissioners.
Questions from the commissioners?
Drew, do you have any issues with salt and so forth in the winter? Are these roads salted and sanded?
I don't know the answer to that question, Brad, if they are salted and sanded. Meredith?
They were last year because we've got plowed, but most of the time we have so many potholes, we don't get plowed.
Okay.
And they never, and if we do, we never get sand and salt.
Okay. What is the resource there? Is that that little private pond behind the sports bar?
That's correct. Yeah, Catakin Pond. Hmm. Yep.
Other questions? I'm sorry, Drew, go for it.
I was going to say it's inland bank and then it's land under water bodies and waterways, which is the resource area, the pond itself.
Okay.
And we'll provide oversight on this to make sure that, you know, it doesn't get worse. I mean, what I saw, what they were doing was actually helping to improve a situation that looked pretty bad and is resulting in some pretty serious puddling of water where it's just a matter of routine maintenance to get it to go to a structure that's been in place for years, and it really should be routed to that structure, that storm drain.
Other questions? Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion for an administrative approval.
I would move for an administrative approval in regards to this situation that we have been reviewing. I don't have the address or so forth.
Thank you, Brad. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Charlie. Voting. Brad.
Yes.
Charlie.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Paul. I think you're muted, Paul, but that looks like an aye to me.
Wave your hand, Paul. I think that's a yay.
Take that as a yay. Motion carries. Yeah. Thank you very much.
There you go, yes. Paul.
Sorry about that. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Shut up.
Meredith?
Yes.
I'll be in touch with you. I just don't carry out any additional work as of yet. And I'll be in touch tomorrow and we'll just go over, you know, what needs to be done just one more time before you proceed. Okay.
All right. Great. I do appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, Meredith.
All right. And thank you, Drew.
Sure.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, if it's all right with you and the commissioners, we should probably jump over to the hearings if there are no objections.
No, I'm going to admit the applicants here.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Tara Martin. Tara, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Oh, she's connecting to audio. Hey, Tara.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. I tried to call on the phone too because I wasn't getting in on the Zoom and I was nervous I was going to miss the meeting. But no, I just hung up on that.
Okay, good. So, yeah, so I don't know if you wanted to screen share, Tara, or I can do it. It's your call, whatever you prefer.
Sure, I can screen share.
All right, let me stop sharing.
Okay.
And then you can go ahead and share when you're ready.
Okay.
All right. In that case, now calling to order the 6 o'clock hearing for New Seabury Properties LLC, 0 off Seanest Drive, proposed restoration of coastal dune with sand nourishment and beach grass. Representative is Woods Hole Group. This is a notice of intent.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. My name is Tara Martin, and I'm with the Woods Hole Group. And I represent New Seabury Properties and New Seabury Golf Course on the project I'm going to present to you right now. So basically, this project is a dune restoration project along a portion of the New Seabury Golf Course. It's a sand nourishment project with beach grass plantings, very similar to some other projects that we have along the New Seabury coastline. I will show you the project locus. So I'm sure that many of you are familiar with the golf course, but there is a project that's at the golf course right now that basically runs from Seaside Village about 1,000 feet to the west. This project starts at the far end of that project and goes about 2,100 feet even further to the west than that. It runs along the third fairway of the golf course. Let me make this a little bit smaller so you can see it. And basically what we're proposing to do here is we're proposing to simply restore the dune with beach grass plantings to provide better resiliency to the dune and to provide a sediment source to the beach. I'd like to share a couple of photos with you so that you can see what the dune looks like right now. So I believe this is the name of this pond here is Lily Pond. Here is the golf course seen here. Some more photos so you can see the scarped dune. There's a narrow section of woody species behind the scarped dune. And basically right onto the fairway right there. This is looking to the east. You can see the homes down here at Seaside. It's pretty narrow through here. You know, different times of the year, the dune looks scarped. You know, usually in the spring and the summer, we get some buildup at the face of the dune here. But as you can see, it's very, very narrow. And it's very low in elevation. So the point of this project is to raise up the elevation to improve the resiliency and make the dune a little bit wider, and just put sand in here so that the project provides better storm damage prevention and flood control when the storms come through here. We have coordinated with Natural Heritage. I reached out to them during the design phase of the project, and they did provide a letter to the commission, and they determined that according to the engineering drawing that we came up with that I will show you next, if we adhere to the specific requirements in their letter, that we would not result in a take. So when we designed the project, we had to maintain 10-to-1 slopes on the seaward side wherever we could. A couple places that we couldn't avoid going a little steeper to a 5-to-1 slope, but they were okay with that. We had time of year restriction from April 1st to August 31st, which is pretty common for these types of projects. The vegetation, they did not want 12 inches on center. They wanted 18 inches on center so that that would be better for the habitat. So of course we agreed to do that. We also have agreed to have a qualified shoreboard monitor that would come and monitor the site every year beginning on April 1st throughout the bird season. They put requirements in of 2 times a week until July 1st. They did say that this authorization through MISA was good for 5 years and that we could do the project in perpetuity through the 5-year period, but then we would have to go back to them. They said it could be completed any time during the 5-year period as long as we stayed in compliance with the engineering drawing. We do have to provide an as-built drawing 60 days after we construct the project. So those were the requirements that Natural Heritage asked us to include in the plan. I'm assuming you would include those in the order of conditions. So this is the project design. This is the footprint of the project. And then these are the cross sections. Does this show up on a big board where you are? Everybody's looking on a screen. Okay, so.
Yeah.
Couple locations where the dune, where we couldn't adhere to the 10-to-1 slope, but we did do a 5-to-1 slope. The dune slope on the backside is 3-to-1 everywhere, because basically on the backside of the dune here, we're right on the fairway or the cart path. There's really nowhere to go on the backside. But I don't really think this is suitable habitat back here anyways, because I mean, you're literally on the golf course. So at station 2.00, we did have a 5-to-1 slope on the seaward side, but at most of the other locations, we did a 10-to-1 slope. The dune crest elevation will be raised to elevation 12. So these cross sections are going further to the east. So we were able to adhere to a 10-to-1 slope. All of these are, you know, way above the mean high water mark, above the high tide line. So this project is just specific to the Mashpee Conservation Commission and DEP. Wetlands and Waterways. They did not provide any comments, at least that I saw on the project, neither for nor against it. Typically, if they have an issue, they would send comments saying that they had an issue with it. But I think where we had worked out all of the details with Natural Heritage, the DEP probably doesn't have any concerns with the project. So the project includes approximately 25,000 cubic yards along the entire 2,100 feet of dune, and it would include beach grass plantings from the dune crest. There is a typical cross section for the beach grass here somewhere, but the beach grass plantings would be done at 18 inches on center, 2 culms per hole, you know, per Natural Heritage. We're not proposing to do any sand fence or anything like that here. It's strictly a sand nourishment project with beach grass plantings. Other than that, I'm not really sure that access for this would be from the New Seabury Golf Course. They do a lot of sand nourishment projects right now along that first stretch of the golf course, which starts at the second tee box and moves along the second fairway. So we would use the same access and come down the beach like they do for that project there. This basically builds on to the end of that project, but that project obviously has a bank stabilization because it was a bank there before we did the work. And then it has the zigzag fencing out in front. But this project doesn't have any of that. So we'd use the same access that we do for that project. And, the beach would be regraded. We don't usually have any issues with tide attractions. We wash out pretty quickly with the next tide that comes through. So I believe it's relatively straightforward. I'm sure some people may have some questions that I'm happy to answer.
Drew, your take?
Yeah, I don't really have too much to add to this. I guess just one word, Tara, and I'm assuming you already are well familiar with this, is, you know, trying to achieve some sort of grain size compatibility out there, because this sand will be taken out, you know, with wave energy. So can you just touch on that, please?
Sure. So we did do grain size samples on the beach, and before any sand is brought to the site, whoever the contractor is, Pastore does a lot of the nourishment out here now, we will require them to provide grain size analysis from wherever they get the sand. A lot of the sand right now is coming from Cape Cod aggregate. So we typically request that, but we will request from either Cape Cod aggregate or Pastore, the grain size analysis that they provide from the quarry to make sure that it's compatible with what we did in our grain size analysis for this project.
Okay, thank you.
And we oversee all of this construction. You know, I make sure that when I go out there that the sand is compatible.
Yeah, that was my, that leads into my next, not really question, but just, you know, recommendation, or we can make it a condition if the commission wishes, is that, you know, we did have a couple of situations where the contractor used machinery to go out and check on erosion, you know, during the off-limit season. And we really want to make sure that that gets clamped down. So if you guys are going to be doing the monitoring, or whoever is going out there to do the monitoring, if you guys aren't doing it, that they're fully aware of this time of year restriction. This was about a year ago.
Oh, and, okay.
The contractor who just took a spin down the beach in the front end loader. And
I remember.
Rutting. Yeah, you remember that.
Yep.
We just tell him to take his lunch break where he is and not
right.
So,
okay.
Easy enough to condition, but we just want to make sure that everybody is aware, you know, who's going
to
be out
there. Of course.
Sometimes communication gets lost between consultants and contractors. So we just want to make sure that everybody's on the same page when it comes to that time of year restriction.
Well, we do provide the order of conditions to them. I think what happened on that project, I'm not always involved when they put sand out at the golf course because they already have an order of conditions. So a lot of time New Seabury will just call Pastore. I think one of their workers was just out there and just was clueless about the whole situation. And I don't think that New Seabury had any idea that this guy was driving a front end loader down the beach, you know, in April. But I will make sure, and we addressed that at the time, I remember, because everybody was pretty upset, and I don't think that will happen again, but I will make sure I reiterate that to the client and obviously to the contractor.
Sure. Okay. I appreciate that.
Sure.
Nothing else to add. It does, you know, with those natural heritage conditions that Tara went over, those will be incorporated into an order if the commission approves the project. All other aspects of this beach nourishment, all standard conditions for beach nourishment, advanced notice, staking, you know, everything that goes along the grain size compatibility, all of those conditions will be the same for this particular project. And so I'll pass it back to the commissioners.
Questions or comments from the commissioners? Hearing none, is there anyone in the audience who would like to make comment?
You know what, I'm going to, if you just give me a moment, I'm just going to, I have to admit everybody into the meeting, and I don't know if some of these people may be commenting on this project. When we're not on television, all I see is random cell phone numbers. I don't see names. So I have to admit everybody. And what I'll do when I do that is I'll make an announcement that we're on this particular hearing. And if you're not associated with this hearing or commenting, to mute your audio and have audio muted until your particular hearing comes up. So just give me a moment to do that while these people are joining.
Hello?
Hi.
So we'll just let everybody get in for a moment. Okay, everybody that I just let into the meeting, we have to do it this way. We have to invite everybody in at once because when we're not on television, all I see is cell phone numbers. here for what reason. Right now we're on the 6 o'clock hearing rather for Zero Seanest Drive. This is the New Seabury Golf Course Beach Nourishment Project. Is anyone on the line here to speak for that or comment on that project with any concerns or questions? And I'm not talking about the consultant. Anyone else to speak to that? Hearing nobody, I ask that everybody please mute your audio. And when we're ready to call your hearing, you can unmute and we'll proceed from there. Thank you. Okay, right. Chad.
Well, we'll entertain a motion. I believe this is a notice of intent.
It is.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we close and issue the application of New Seabury Properties LLC at Zero Off Seanest Drive.
Thank you, Brad. Do I hear a second?
I second that.
Thank you, Charlie. Voting. Brad.
Yes.
Charlie.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Paul.
Yes.
I vote yes as well. Motion carries.
Great. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
Have a good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now calling to order, as Drew admits, the appropriate attendees, the 6:03 hearing for William T. and Kathleen M. Humphrey, 29 Secansa Point Road. Proposed amended order of conditions with addition of fill to elevate garage to previously approved demolition and reconstruction of single family dwelling, hardscape, landscape modifications, and mitigation plantings. Representative is Falmouth Engineering, and this is an amended order of conditions.
Is anyone on the line here to represent 29 Secansa Point Road?
Yes, I am. Bill Humphrey. I'm actually representing, Mike couldn't make the meeting tonight, so
okay,
I
Bill.
Guess I'm representing for him if I could.
Sure. So I have the GIS image of the property up on the screen, and then I can move to the plan. If you want to start your presentation, just state your name for the record and proceed with the description of your project request.
Certainly. William T. Humphrey, owner of 29 Secansa Point Road. I'm also the builder of the property too. And what we're requesting here is originally we proposed putting in the garage. The garage is staying right where it is. But I think what happened is, it slipped here, is Falmouth Engineering, because we want the elevation of the proposed garage floor to be, like right now you see the elevation, existing elevation there is elevation 10. And the floodplain is elevation 11. So we wanted my wife and I want the floor to be out of the floodplain. So Mike put it at elevation, the new elevation you'll see, the proposed is 11.5. So doing that, we have to do the fill that we take out of the excavation there. We need to do a little incidental filling to get the water to go away so it won't pond in that area. So you'll see like on the west side of the house, the existing grade is 10.7. To get the water away, elevations of 11.2, and then at the garage floor he's got 11.5, and it's running out to the center of the driveway, which is 10.2. So it's just minor filling, just to get the water away from the garage. It's not much at all, but it wasn't on the plan originally. That's the problem. So we want to file a CLOMA with the building department, and the building inspector is saying, well, what are we filling here? There's no elevation. So she's right. So we need to show that. So I think it just slipped by. It's very minor. It's incidental filling for the construction of that. The same as around the house. You'll see the old house. If you look at the grades, the old house had elevations. You'll see in the front left and right one is 11.3. There's 11.7. We want the new proposed house to be up above the floodplain. So the filling had to be, so the elevation of the new house is at elevation 13. So incidental filling is, instead of being 11.3, it's up to 12.5, about 7 or 8 inches. So just same as like we're doing on the garage. So it's minor filling to get the water to run away from the garage.
Drew, comments?
Not much to, if anyone is on the line and not speaking on 29th Secaucet Point Road, please mute your computer. Mute your audio. Thank you. Not much to add. It's pretty straightforward, as Bill had described. It's just getting that elevation. These are photos of the site. The GIS image that I showed before shows the pre-existing house, because that's the GIS isn't up to date with the current conditions out there. So this is what the site looks like now. It's a previous order that was issued for the teardown rebuild of this this existing house here. So you can see that construction is happening now. And this area, looking at the top left over by this dumpster, that's the location of the garage. And then this bottom left is just looking at where the front of the garage would be facing, looking back out towards the road. So, and then just going back over to the plan here, you can see the garage is well set back from the coastal bank, which I'll pan out, show you where that is. Over here, it's an armored coastal bank leading down to Wacoya Bay. So, and then you've got eventual mitigation that'll be put into this location here. And there's the garage here. So just a minor amount of fill to get it out of the flood zone. Meets all the performance standards for land subject to coastal storm flowage. Doesn't change the scope of work all that dramatically. And that's why they're coming in with this amended order for some grading changes to get it up and out of the flood zone. So no other comments, and I'll pass it back to the commissioners.
Thank you, Drew.
Questions, and Chad, sorry, Alexandra Zola is here. She's our newest commissioner, so just make sure you call her.
Absolutely, thank you, Drew. Questions or comments from the commissioners?
If you're on the line, please mute your audio.
No.
All right, hearing none. Well, is there anyone in the audience that is looking to comment on this particular hearing?
Everyone's in, so.
All right, in that case, we'll entertain a motion. This is an amended order of conditions.
I move that we approve the open order of conditions on the property of William T. and Kathleen M. Humphrey at 29 Secaucet Point Road.
Thank you, Brad. Do I hear a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Charlie.
Yeah.
Voting, Brad.
Yes.
Paul.
Wave your hand, Paul.
Yes.
Charlie.
Yes.
Yes.
Lots of yeses. Tom.
Hi.
And Alexandra.
Yes.
I apologize for not calling on you earlier. I vote aye as well. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Bill.
All right. Have a good night.
All right. Now calling to order the 606 hearing for Stacy Kushner. 23 Samoset Road. This is an after the fact request to permit an existing fence. Representative is Stacy Kushner. This is our RDA.
Stacy, can you hear us?
Yes. Hi. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, board members, and thank you to Drew. My name is Stacy Kushner. I'm the attorney of record. And the property where the fence is on is at 23 Samoset Road in Mashpee. The owners are Susan Roth and Catherine Edelstein. I am not a co-owner. And I will refer to them as the co-owners, and they are my sisters. I do want to state on behalf of the co-owners that they apologize for what has transpired and wish to make this right. So I do want to state that at the outset. And we'll comply with what the commissioners order. Okay, so a little bit of a background. The subject fence went up in February of 2021, and it was placed there by our father, who is Dr. Richard Kushner, who is at 22 Samoset Road. It was not placed there by Susan Roth or Catherine Edelstein. And it was placed there because there was ongoing destruction of trees and growth there that actually been happening since 2017. We wrote in the RDA application that it had happened, it transpired first in 2020, but in going back over some notes, I realized that it started in 2017 when the neighbor, Mr. Jim Whitney, had started to systematically take away and destroy all the trees and growth that was along the property line that is where he is at 21 Metacomet Road and 23 Samoset Road. And Dr. Kushner is at his property. Our father is at his property in Mashpee weekly, and the co-owners are generally not there. They visit once in a while. Mr. Whitney has, in our opinion, illegally removed many trees and growth in that area. And the co-owners have tried to talk to Mr. Whitney to tell him to stop doing this and to replant trees, but he has failed in this regard. Just to give you an example of one thing he did, in March 2017, the roundabout near the 23 Samoset property was damaged by Mr. Whitney because he placed a natural gas line on the 23 Samoset Road on the subject property. The line went through the co-owner's property, and after complaining to him, finally the line was removed. So the co-owners and Dr. Kushner.
I'm just going to stop you for a
moment. There's some noise on the line. Yeah, I'll stop.
Yeah, stop for a moment. If anybody's on the line whose computer is not muted, please mute your audio. We can hear you, and it's interfering with this particular hearing. So please mute your audio if you are not being heard currently before the commission. Don't unmute until your hearing is called. Thank you.
Okay. It sounds good now. As I was saying, the co-owners, Susan Roth and Catherine Edelstein and Dr. Kushner, our dad, have been incredibly aggravated by Mr. Whitney. And when the fence went up in February 2021, Dr. Kushner, who placed it there, didn't know about having to file for a permit. And my father will be 90 years old in a few days. I just want to add that. The fence people did not state this either. And after went up, conservation agent Drew McManus came by to talk to Dr. Kushner about filing an RDA application, which we did. And I personally do not know of any, I did not know of any controversy about the fence permit until I received a request for help from my dad after he met with Drew. I want to state clearly now that the co-owners are very willing to comply with what the board members wish them to do, including taking out two parts of the fence. And again, I want to make it very clear that they will comply with your order. They want to comply and put this to rest. We have seen the many written complaints from the neighbors sent in to the conservation department. And while views are important, we don't believe they're relevant to issues of wetland protections. Several neighbors would be fined with two sections of the fence being taken out. So I've just listed a few. I hope I'm not misstating this, but from what I see, it's Jeff Kobach, Roz Rosenberg, Laura Foscher, Richard Gorbati, and the South Cape Homeowners Association, and there may be more. And again, subject to the board's direction, the co-owners can do that. So we thank you for your time and we thank you for listening. I have no further comments.
Chad, you're muted.
Yeah, just figured that out. Thank you, Ms. Kushner. Drew, comments?
So yeah, that Mrs. Kushner's description, you know, pretty much describes all the events leading up to this fence. There was some abutters who were confused that the fence may have been put up by the owner of 21 Metacomet, and I have, each time I've seen that situation, I've clarified that the fence was not put up by Mr. Whitney. It was put up by the owner of 22 Samoset. So, and I did speak to him. I guess my only comment, and it's really probably neither here nor there, but you know, the statement that that you weren't aware, or that nobody was aware, including the contractors, that this involved wetlands jurisdiction, when you look at the photos and you see where the fence ends, there just can be absolutely no question that it's wetlands jurisdiction. I don't care who you are, you see the water, you're within jurisdiction. So I don't buy that excuse that nobody was aware. They certainly were. There's no question about it in my mind. So so ignorance is not at play here. The fence was constructed without a permit. As you can see here, just to show the photos, top left or leftmost photo, this is the beginning of the fence going down towards the coast here, the coastline. And then it terminates this right here. This bush is approximately the edge of bordering vegetated wetlands. So this is the extent of commonly flooded, periodically flooded land. Bordering vegetated wetland is a resource area protected under the Wetlands Protection Act and Mashpee's Chapter 172 Wetland Bylaw. The two panels here, you can see that Mrs. Kushner had stated, and correctly so, that a few of the abutters, association members, and the association itself would be happy to have removed. In my opinion, it should be the three panels, the first or the last three panels here, because if you're introducing structure, had we been made aware of this project before it got built, we would have told you, you can't get within 50 feet of bordering vegetated wetland with structure. But we never had that opportunity because the fence was erected without a permit. So that would have been the input, and it would have stopped right here, which is approximately about 50 feet away from the BVW. So that's my recommendation, that three panels be removed. If the applicant has any issue with that.
No, we don't have any issue. We can do that.
Okay. Okay, good.
We're good with that.
Yeah. The other issue that, because it is an extremely long fence, almost over 200 feet, is that, again, had we known this fence was going to be built, we told you 6 inches of clearing under the bottom for wildlife passage, which is a boilerplate condition for fences that are solid like this. And a fence of this length definitely does impede wildlife transition corridor from one area to the next. So again, we never had that chance for input, and there should be 6 inches of clearing underneath the bottom rail separation from the ground.
I will tell you, I think the contract actually did provide for that, and I don't know why that it looks like that.
Well, I don't either, but it does. That's going to need to be addressed as well along the entire length, because this, it's not just a matter of a 100-foot setback from BVW. This entire subdivision is within land subject to coastal storm flowage, so it is all jurisdictional, the entire fence, and then past it landward by several hundred feet. So that needs to be addressed as well. So that's my recommendation to the commission, is the last three panels, and that assurance that there's 6 inches of clearance underneath the fence along its entire length.
Okay.
I'll pass.
Your question, does the remaining, let's assume that we agree and the three panels are to be removed that you mentioned, and the clearance from the ground is either confirmed to be or increased to be 6 inches along the entire length. Does what exists trigger mitigation planting?
You know, to be honest, in looking at the fence, and I've been out there several times, you know, just to assess it, it looks to me like the footprint that it occupies and how it was installed involved very, very minimal disturbance to vegetation. There were no trees removed for this fence, so it was some minor cutting of shrubs. And I'm not downplaying it, I'm just telling you what I saw. So if the commission wishes to require mitigation for the fence, it's your call. My observation is that it was very minimal disturbance in installing this fence, just due to the very narrow footprint. And when you follow along the track, I saw no cut stumps of any significant size.
Thank you, Drew.
Sure.
Other commissioners, questions or comments?
My name is Kevin Donio.
Commissioners.
Hi, Kevin. We're still with the commission itself. We will open it up to the public shortly.
My apologies. Thank you.
No worries. Commissioners, members of the Conservation Commission, other questions or comments?
Chad, if we were to excavate underneath this fence for the entire length to create that 6-inch opening, would that trigger some mitigation?
I don't believe it does, but I'll defer to Drew.
It's really your call. I mean, there could be some, you know, opportunity for mitigation along the coastline here. I wouldn't recommend putting anything in close to this escarpment here, which is really a result of repeated wave energy, ice rafting over the years that has caused this natural erosion to happen. And then Mr. Whitney's activities over here didn't help matters very much. But, you know, there is some opportunity over here. He has mitigation plantings in this area on 23 Samoset, as he's required to do through an enforcement order. And that enforcement order still extends another 3 years, or four years rather, of monitoring and maintenance requirements to make sure that everything he's planted survives and thrives. So there is opportunity set back from the bank, because you don't want to have wasted plantings just falling into the BVW flooded area over here. But there's some opportunity
for
coastal plantings if you require.
Okay.
Hi, I just want to clarify, if for that 6 inches, the fence is only to be raised. We're not excavating underneath it, correct?
If it can be raised, we haven't really got into that part of the discussion yet, Alex. I mean, I'm basically putting the burden of creating 6 inches of clearance on the fence owners to do just that.
Yeah.
So whether that, you know, involves digging, I think raising, because we never had the opportunity for input prior to construction. Yeah. So I would go with raising as opposed to digging, because that's just more impact from something that was unpermitted.
Right. So
if that means it has to be dismantled and raised up, then that's what has to happen.
Right, okay. And then I just want to follow up. The enforcement order that you were just referring to, was that on the Whitney property or on this property?
It was on the Whitney property.
Okay.
Other questions from the commissioners? All right, hearing none. I would like to address everybody who's from the public who's waiting to comment on this particular hearing. I'd like to remind, because there has been a significant amount of interest, and there are certainly a number of people here whose voices will be heard tonight. I'd like to remind everyone that the purview of the Conservation Commission is only to consider matters of conservation and within conservation jurisdiction. Other matters, grievances, concerns that do not concern conservation we are not allowed nor permitted to take into account when making any kind of decision. So for those commenting, I please ask that you, in the interest of everyone's time, stick to your concerns that are appropriate for the Conservation Commission. That having said, I guess this is a little bit of an odd way to do it, thanks to the technology we need to embrace. But who's going to speak first? Please identify yourself.
I'd like to speak. My name is Dr. Robin Joyce. I'm a neighbor, and I first want to acknowledge the comments by my neighbor about the willingness to make changes. My major concerns were, I saw the same concern she had, that the Whitney property was completely out of line and destroyed a lot of the protective coastline there. With the remediations that she was proposing, the two concerns that I have that persist is that the fence is a flat, solid pane, And my concern is for wind shear forces against that with the remaining panels that could disrupt with either them blowing over or disrupting the ground and not being clear that the true benefit for the progression of wildlife. I would wonder if the fence's purpose is to prohibit the neighbor from disturbing any more of her property, if a different format of a fence would be more acceptable.
I don't know. Should I respond to that? I mean, this is Stacy Kushner.
I have no idea.
I mean, Stacy? I think the fence is, yes.
Stacy? Yes. I think we're going to go through public comment first before it's just going to be too confusing. Oh. To step in.
Do you want me to respond in any way or do I not?
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. Chad, you're muted.
Sorry, my dog found a squeak toy. For the next commenter, if you could please identify yourself for the record and speak your concerns as to the conservation issues surrounding this project.
Hi, good evening. This is Richard Gorbity. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So, you know, I saw the fence. I was horrified by it. I understand the problem with Mr. Whitney, and I'm glad that there is enforcement making sure that he replants everything that he destroyed. I'm sorry for the Kushners, but again, I think from our association and our neighborhood perspective, we're happy that they're willing to make the adjustments that are necessary. But again, going into conservation, we still have the problem of animal migration, wind, and everything that was just brought up by the other individual. So I don't know if they're adjusting the fence. Maybe they can take out every fourth lattice or something. I don't even know what kind of fence it is, but if there's any possibility of, I don't know. That would be up to Mr. McManus. But thank you for your work on this. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Richard. The next person wishing to comment, please identify yourself for the record and speak your piece.
Yes, hello. My name is Kevin Donio. I live at 16 Neshobee Road. I've seen the fence in question. To the left of that property, to an uneducated eye, it appears to be an empty lot. So I'm not sure of the necessity of an 8-foot animal fence leading down to the waterline, especially for a pristine area such as this. It inhibits the view of really everyone coming down Great River or leaving Great River or on any Great River beach. I just want to go on record as saying that I'm opposed to the process that was followed here and the allowance of a fence of this nature to be built in an area where, frankly, you need a permit to trim your shrubs. I don't understand why a fence of this nature can be built without any permitting process. Maybe I'm overlooking something. However, I do believe it's an eyesore. And I do believe that some sort of mediation can be achieved without a vindictive process such as this to build a fence of this nature along a neighbor to create a neighborly dispute. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next person who would like to comment, if there is someone, please identify yourself for the record and speak your conservation concerns.
Hi, this is Kelly Knight, 52 Nahoyden Road. And I had more of a question I was hoping you could address once we're all done with our public comment. Oh, maybe there's a big delay. I had a question. So during the presentation and the follow-up by your commission, there's been a couple times where people have said, if you had come before us before you built this thing, which is very large and very disturbing, if you had come before us, we would have, from the beginning, told you X. We would have told you you needed 6 inches of clearance. We would have told you that you can't go to this point. I don't understand, and I would hope that you would explain to us what other things you would have suggested from the beginning that are not being met by this current fence. Because I can't imagine that it's taking down 4 completely solid panels and raising it up by 6 inches that would have been the extent of getting this approved in the first place. So I think that we would all benefit from understanding how, if this was coming to you as a brand new proposal, how you would have addressed it in a way that isn't this kind of ask for forgiveness methodology that seems to be used here. So I would really appreciate if you could give us some information around that. Thank you.
Great point.
Drew, yeah, I can give, I can try my best to answer that. So in any instance, when we encounter a violation, we look at, first and foremost, obviously the impact that it may have caused or did cause or is currently causing. But we also look at the scope of the project, all the nature of the project, and is it something that would have been permittable on some level? And I can tell you firsthand, the commission has approved hundreds of fences in various areas throughout the town. Fences that look like this, fences that look different, split rails, picket fences, wire fences, all manner of fences. So when you look at a fence of this size and proportion, the first thing I think of, and I go back and look at our permitting history, is have we permitted something like this before? And the answer is undoubtedly, yes, we have. With the, you know, adjustments that I mentioned earlier, which is, you know, making sure, and the commission has been very consistent with the aspect of wildlife passage. If it's not a perimeter fence, and it's, you know, in this case, we're asking it to be reduced by 4 panels and have clearance underneath for wildlife passage. And the commission has been very consistent in that regard. Perimeter fences certainly do provide an impediment to wildlife passage, but an open-ended fence does not. So when it comes to impact to wildlife habitat, while, you know, it does provide somewhat of a barricade, it doesn't impede wildlife passage, particularly with the adjustments that I would hope the commission would require moving forward in this permit request, which is the 6 inches underneath passage, because you're mostly dealing with small mammals in this area. And then removal of the last three panels to get it away from the water, away from probably the most, you know, severe area of the flood zone. So scaling it back by 3 panels puts it behind some pretty significant vegetation, which affords natural protection. So when it comes to wind and wave energy, the removal of those 3 panels instead of 2 will really ensure the integrity of this fence to stay there and not become, you know, stormborne debris wash out into the water and start impacting, you know, the marine environment. So you scale it back that far, it's afforded natural protection by the existing vegetation that's there. And I've gone out and looked at this thing several times. So I can assure you that 3 panels will cure that potential concern. So that's the best answer I can really give, Kelly, is that, you know, if the commission has gone through a permitting process before for something similar or, you know, close to it, there's no reason to not look at it with the same sort of assessment moving forward, even if it's a violation. I mean, the whole purpose is, you know, this hearing is to assess it, look at it, look at the impacts, look at the regulations, do a comparison and see how it matches up, and then make any necessary adjustments accordingly. So that's the best answer I can give.
Okay, thank you. And so I just wanted to be clear, you know, I've spent time on my zoning board up here in Hopkinton, so I'm familiar with precedent and all that kind of stuff. My original question had just been, if they had come to you from day one and said, we want to build a fence, are there other considerations besides the ones that we've heard tonight that would have been considered that we should be considering tonight when we talk about the neighbors potentially doing what the commission wants to be done? And we've heard about the panels and the wildlife egress, being able to access the land and everything. And I think those are great. And the wind shear, I hadn't really thought about, but that's an awesome point. Are there other things that usually come up during permitting processes that we should be thinking about? That's all. Thank you, though.
Thank you. Just to answer that, I mean, it's really based on what is being proposed, you know, before the commission that dictates what, you know, how they would go about permitting it. But, you know, fences are relatively small footprint, narrow, low impact for the most part. So if they had come to, let's say they come to me before they had brought this before the commission, I would have made the same recommendations that I'm making tonight.
All right. Is there anyone else in the audience who would like to identify themselves and be heard on their conservation concerns with this project? Hearing none, I'd like to the commissioners, if there's any other questions you have, having heard the public's commentary, go ahead and make your questions or comments. Otherwise, we'll entertain a motion. All right, hearing none.
I do have one comment, Chad, sorry.
Yeah, no.
If the commission were to issue a negative determination on this project, which I would, you know, I would recommend, I would also recommend that part of the motion be the issuance of an enforcement order for the removal of the three panels and providing 6 inches of clearance underneath the entirety of the structure for wildlife passage. And enforced, because an RDA, if you issue a negative determination, which would be in effect just approve the fence, but those measures can't be enforced through an RDA. So I would ask that you include in your motion for the issuance of an enforcement order to the property owners to ensure that those conditions, and those conditions should also be part of the motion, that make that situation enforceable, because effectively a negative determination means that conditions don't apply. So we can issue an enforcement order. It's the most effective tool in situations like this where you want to ensure compliance. So that would be my recommendation.
To add to that, I'd like to, just in the interest of expedience, if the only option becomes to excavate under the fence to the 6 inches, we could potentially require mitigation. And I'd like to see that be part of the enforcement order. And to the owner of the fence, I think I'd just like to clarify, is the area where we're asking the panels to be removed a helpful location for mitigation planting?
Certainly, if the commission wishes us to do some mitigation planting, that's certainly something we can do, as well as excavate under the fence 6 inches, as well as remove those three panels. And just to give us a date certain by when that has to happen.
Understood. Drew, with the location of the three panels that we potentially are asking to be removed, is that a beneficial location for mitigation planting? Obviously, I'm trying to find something that's mutually beneficial where it benefits the environment and provides the privacy that the owner was looking for in the first place.
So there could be some good opportunity there, just in that kind of, you know, on their side of the property, obviously not on Mr. Whitney's property, but Mr. Whitney has mitigation shrubs in that area because that's what we require. So it's a little bit unusual as far as his enforcement. It does go on to another property because he caused that issue on that property.
Right.
So some of the mitigation is on 23 Samoset and will be maintained as such through that violation. However, in that bottom right photo that you see, those three panels when they're taken out, there are a variety of coastal shrubs or even, you know, various, you know, coastal shrubs. We don't want to have them plant trees because then you've got the whole issue of view popping up again. So groundsel tree, any variety of coastal shrub would be very well suited to be planted in that area, just to kind of, you know, add integrity of that, because you can see really taking quite the abuse from from wave energy and ice rafting here. This is all natural erosion. This is undercutting of a coastal bank, and it's common in a lot of areas. When you've got storm surges coming in, it just continually eats away at the shoreline here. So that is something, you know, outside of the purposes of today's hearing, that's something the property owners are going to need to pay attention to at some point, because it's just going to keep getting worse.
I do have a question for you, Drew. How many bushes and what type does the commission want to see, or would you, on behalf of the commission, want to see?
Stacey, I think that's
needing some guidance.
Yeah.
That's sure. Something that if you're willing, after a ruling by this commission, you can work with our with Drew on to ensure the proper mitigation is planted and the location of that mitigation.
Okay, thank you. Will do.
Thank you. All right, commissioners, we'll entertain a motion. I'd hopefully like to hear the concerns Drew stated mitigated, but it is your option to either motion for negative determination or ask for an enforcement order.
It can be and, not or.
This is true.
I would move for a negative determination in regards to the situation of Stacy Kushner et al. At 23 Somerset Road, and that we have an enforcement order issued to remove three sections of fence in order to comply with the enforcement order.
Brad, would you like to add anything about the clearance?
Drew's discretion, the fence may have to be raised 6 inches to allow for wildlife transit.
Thank you, Brad. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Charlie. Voting. Charlie.
Yes.
Brad.
Yes.
Paul.
Yes.
Thank you. Tom.
Aye.
Alexandra.
Yes.
And yes. I vote aye as well. Wow, we get a lot of yeses in there. Motion carries. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. And thank you to the commission.
Thank you.
And Drew, thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. While Drew brings the appropriate people into conference, I'll call to order the 609 hearing for the town of Mashpee, 664 Great Neck Road South. This is a proposed amended order of conditions to add a concrete scour pad to previously approved reconfiguration of an existing dock. Representative is Cape and Islands Engineering. This is an amended order of conditions.
Good evening. For the record, Matt Costa, Cape and Islands Engineering. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, Matt.
Loud and clear, Matt.
Thank you. We're here tonight on behalf of the town of Mashpee, requesting to amend the existing order of conditions. excuse me, the resource areas for this, Drew has it pulled up on the screen here. This is the Aquay boat ramp. Your resource areas include land under the ocean, salt marsh, BBW, and coastal bank, and land subject to coastal storm flowage. Commission members may remember this project from not too long ago, where we were requesting the addition of some floats shown for or used for shellfish propagation. So that's what the existing order of conditions was issued for. We're here tonight because we want to amend that to include the addition of a scour pad at the end of the boat ramp. Since we permitted this project last, there's been a situation identified at the end of the boat ramp that's the cause of power loading and unloading of boats. And we're proposing to fill the area with stone and place a pre-fabricated concrete slab, 10 by 17 pad that would be placed in the water at the end of the boat ramp to protect the ocean floor from this power dredging. The project this slab, we're not requiring to do any dewatering here, any construction actually in the water. This would be placed from a crane from upland area. So there's very minimal impact. The project does meet the performance standards, and we are respectfully requesting you issue a new order of conditions. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Matt. Drew, comments?
Not too much to add to that. Matt, do you have any estimated like timeline for project completion for something like this? 1 day, 2 days? What are your?
It would be 1 day.
1 day. Okay. And I'm just going to switch over to the PowerPoint here just to show the commissioner some images of the project site. This is on Great Neck Road South, leading up to the entrance to New Seabury on your left-hand side if you're heading towards South Mashpee. So top left photo, looking at the existing ramp going down, adjacent fixed pier and ramp here. And then bottom left, just to show the area out to the left of the existing fixed pier. The next piers over are well separated, so there won't be any interference with this work navigation-wise for any of the adjacent areas here. And then the right photo just shows you've got fringe salt marsh and some riprap here adjacent to the existing boat ramp. And I can attest to the fact that the power loading here is quite common, and it really does, you know, given the silty substrate of Aquay Bay, and it really does send silt flying and really degrades the area even further. So this will definitely be an upgrade to prevent that power loading from happening. And we'll go to help, you know, improve conditions out here at least, you know, somewhat. It is an impacted embayment, so the improvements will only go so far, but it'll certainly help to alleviate that power loading issue at this town facility. So nothing more to add. The Harbor Master has signed off on this, no issues, as has Shellfish. It is not a viable shellfish area. But in terms of any eventual restoration, again, this will be a significant benefit. So no other comments.
Thank you, Drew. Questions or comments from the commissioners?
Right. I'm just curious. Is the power loading happening because of a lack of parking? Why is it happening to begin with?
No. So power loading is when people load their boat on the trailer using the engine.
Oh, okay.
That yeah, coming from the water side.
Prop wash. It's okay. The prop wash coming off the engine that creates the hole at the end of the ramp.
Yeah.
Okay. So this will allow them to get deeper.
Well, what this will do is it's actually going to protect the substrate from that that flow coming off the back of the engine. So you got two types of flow in water: laminar flow, which is like a more direct flow, and then turbulent flow, which is chaotic. So this pad actually will have a bumpy surface to it, technical term. Okay. And that's going to create turbulent flow off that pad, so it's not directed at the substrate. So it'll essentially bounce off the pad and protect it. It'd be great if we could stop people from power loading, but
right.
We haven't solved that problem yet.
Okay, I understand.
Other questions from the commissioners? Hearing none, is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak on this matter? Wow, just like the last one. All right, we'll entertain a motion. This is an amended order of conditions.
I would move to approve the amended open order of conditions for the town of Mashpee at 664 Great Neck Road South.
Second.
Thank you, Brad. Thank you, Charlie. Now voting. Alexandra.
Yes.
Charlie.
Yes.
Brad.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Paul.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And I vote aye as well. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
All right, now calling to order the 6-12 hearing for Pompanesset Beach Owners Association. This is at 0 Uncle Percy's Road. Proposed control of growth of nuisance and or invasive plant species in and around Dean's Pond. Representative Solitude Lake Management has been continued from 4/22, and this is a notice of intent.
Hi, can everyone hear me?
Loud and clear.
Yeah. Good. Keith Gazelle with Solitude Lake Management, representing the applicant. Essentially what we've proposed is we've actually, and the Beach Owners Association has long been actively managing nuisance and invasive plant growth in the pond, probably for, off and on the better part of a decade. And so really this notice of intent is to really continue that effort. In recent years, the group has observed kind of increases in submersed plant growth throughout the pond, specifically admittedly native pond weeds that have begun to kind of occupy kind of a large percentage of the pond. In addition, they continue to experience growth of non-native purple loosestrife along the shoreline, albeit fairly sparse at this point, as well as common reed or Phragmites australis as well. And so really the proposed program is to continue to selectively manage to maintain areas of open water habitat, to minimize the expansion and growth of the non-native plant species, again, to try and maintain a stable and healthy aquatic environment. And so the focus of the program really will be kind of a monitoring program where we will be visiting and observing and collecting data on the pond on a monthly basis. And really with that information, we will be making recommendations to the group as to kind of what we see as being kind of the necessary, management effort to, again, maintain or preserve kind of acceptable conditions. And so we've really provided a whole host of different management strategies in the notice of intent, stemming from techniques that we have used in the past that have been successful. So one is the use of a mechanical hydrorake. Historically, we have done some hydroraking on the pond at the north and really southern extremes of the pond to reduce the encroachment of emergent plant species. I think there has been some recent growth of herbaceous emergent species, particularly at the southern end of the pond, probably stemming from low water levels the last couple of years, and certainly last year when we had definite drought conditions. So I think that there is a need and a desire to, again, selectively kind of push some of that emergent plant growth back to the shorelines and maintain the best possible water conveyance kind of in those areas. So I do believe that there's kind of some flow into the basins from those points. In addition, we have included both aquatic herbicides and algicides, again, really on a contingent basis, if conditions warrant and the growth is beyond what we can effectively manage with what I'll call smaller scale management techniques, which we've also included in the notice, benthic bottom barriers and manual or diver hand pulling. We've included those, and some algicides. There have been reports over some increased filamentous and some microscopic algae growth in recent years. So again, as a contingency, we have included some copper-based algicides for, again, control problematic levels of growth. So I think that's kind of the program in a nutshell. I certainly can answer any questions that the commission might have.
Thank you very much. Drew, comments?
I'm not sure what happened, but on my screen, everything has just gone away and I have a complete blank screen. So I no longer have control over the PowerPoint. I apologize for that. And I've tried several different things to try and get the screen back and nothing is happening. So we will be without the benefit of the PowerPoint moving forward unless by some miracle my screen comes back. In regards to this application, and I can't see anybody, so I don't know if you can see me, but okay, good. My only question is in regards, because I've seen this happen in years past, is when you go through significant periods of lack of precipitation and get into a drought status, and you start to see some of the native, you know, submerged aquatic vegetation emerge above the surface water. And it's been my experience from the PBA members and some surrounding homeowners that that's kind of like panic inducing when it's really just a natural condition of drought. And one of the things I didn't want to see happen is areas like that, you know, being having homeowners of PBA call up Solitude and saying, hey, we can see all this emergent vegetation out of the water, when I'm consistently telling them that the water level is lower than normal. So I don't want to see any kind of situation where you go in hydro raking or aquatic herbicide and hitting native vegetation that's simply exposed due to low water levels. So if you can just touch on that situation, because I have witnessed it firsthand, the panic that happens at low water levels. So I just want to make sure that, you know, everyone is equally informed about that type of situation, and that it's not a situation where invasives are just taking over. It's just that you can see native material due to low water level.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I think the way that we have developed the program and really intend to administer the program is really kind of a collecting information first kind of approach. And so I think that's our hope, is to kind of prevent and be able to educate around the actual management needs. And that I think that we have spent a lot of time with the group, you know, doing that over the years. And I think what you know, the approach that we would take here is, and really has been always our stance, is that overmanagement can create more negative impacts than beneficial ones. So I think that would definitely be our communication to the group, and really the mechanism of having those frequent visits is to be able to kind of have firsthand knowledge as to kind of starting conditions versus kind of the eventual or gradual evolution of those conditions, both vegetation and water level, and be able to kind of communicate intelligently to the group, you know, what is a management requirement, what is a management need, versus something that may be kind of a short-term impact and or seasonal impact as a result of kind of climate and or weather conditions.
Sure. Okay. And I appreciate that. And the other comment that I had, and I'm sure you're already more than well aware of this, is, you know, time of year treatment, you know, when you go in, particularly in regards to hydro raking, that you know, the time of year that happens, what is your input into going in at a time of year where you're not spreading seed because it's, you know, the season for germinating aquatic invasives, that, you know, what is the time of year optimal for hydro raking? So you're not actually making the problem worse.
Yeah. Well, I think that's probably a function of the target plant species more than anything, but, right. again, for most emergent plant species, we're generally trying to target earlier in the growing season, okay. really prior to any seed production to, sure. In essence, mitigate against that potential, spread. Right. However, we have done some later season hydro raking, again, kind of at the other end of the extreme where, seed proliferation is with the plant species such as water lilies, where seed proliferation isn't kind of a large component of, spread or movement of the plant. It's really kind of a rhizomal creep. And so we have often done or targeted the removal of kind of isolated areas of water lilies kind of more in late season. I'll caveat that a little bit with, somewhat of an eye to having observable vegetation still present. I think, that's important in order to kind of maintain kind of the selectivity of the area and to make sure that we're really only targeting and getting the plants that we want to get.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Sure.
No other comments.
Thank you, Drew. Questions from the commissioners? Hearing none, is there anyone in the
audience? Can I? I was going to let someone else go first. I just want to say that I'm excited about this project, and I would hope that you come back and tell us about the success of your methods and what you found. And even if things weren't working, tell us that too, because I want to know how it's going and just your success with it. I just have one question specifically. When you treat the Phragmites, are you swiping or spraying?
Well, I think we've used kind of a variety of different techniques, again, based on density primarily.
Yeah.
But I think historically we've done a cut stem application here because we're not talking, remarkably dense growth patches, and it's fairly widely scattered, I think, at this point. So
right.
I think that would kind of remain the target or most common application technique.
And do you time that, like time of year?
Yeah, typically that is later in the growing season. So yeah. Once the plants have kind of reached full inflorescence, they've kind of developed that flowery tassel at the top, is really the time when treatment works the best. And I'll say, I'll again caveat that with a glyphosate-based herbicide. And so really treatment at that time, the plants are beginning to prepare to overwinter. So they're moving starch reserves to the rhizome. And so therefore application at that time promotes better translocation of the herbicide into the root, and you then get better systemic level control.
Great. Yeah, I found that also. So good.
Good.
That's all.
Thank you. Other commissioners, questions, comments? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion. This is a notice of intent.
Move that we close an issue in regards to the application of Papanesset Beach Owners Association at 0 Uncle Percy's Road.
Thank you, Brad. Thank you, Brad. Thank you, Charlie. Voting, Alexandra.
Yes.
Charlie.
Yes.
Brad.
Yes.
Paul.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now calling the 6:15 hearing for Tom and Patricia Brennan, 126 Somersea Road, proposed demolition and reconstruction of single family dwelling and septic system, hardscape landscape modification and mitigation plantings. Representative is BSS Design. This is an NOI.
Hey, thank you. It's glad to be here tonight. My name is Tom Bunker with BSS Design, representing the Brennans on this project. Saw Drew had some his aerial photo up there.
Oh yeah, I just stopped screen sharing. I know you usually like the screen share, Tom, but if you want me to, I'd be happy to.
Well, I can put mine on. I had the Google aerial up there in case you didn't have your screen back.
Okay, I got it back. It's a miracle.
Yeah, that's good. If I can put mine up right now, I will. Sure. Go through a little bit here.
There's Fido. Can Fido vote?
I'll bleep Fido right now.
So this is the aerial just to show where this project is on Somersea Road. It's in a long line of houses along this bank. Get the photo up here. As you can see, it's one of many in this area along here is a steep coastal bank. Most of these houses have stairs going down the bank, and as you can see, piers going out into the water. Let's see, let's get their existing conditions plan. Basically go over, have the existing house here, rather oddly shaped, one of these houses left over from the 60s or whenever. Oddly shaped, as you can see, it goes all the way up to the edge of the coastal bank in this location right here. Doesn't conform to setback from coastal bank or setback from the street or the side, doesn't conform to any setbacks anywhere. There's a lot of gravel surface on this property. There's a driveway coming up to here. On this side, the sort of crushed stone gravel steps walkway going down around to the lower level of the house, and then under the porch, and then back up. There's a pair, a set of a flight of masonry steps going back up to a retaining wall, and more gravel surface in this location. And basically the only area of shrubs and all other than on the coastal bank is in this location right here. I'll show you the resource areas a little better on this existing conditions plan, or we have Aquay Bay what's it called? Ann's Cove,
right.
Ann's Cove right here, yeah. It's part of Aquay Bay, I guess. And then you go back, Aquay Bay, Ann's Cove, a fairly good sized salt marsh along here, runs up to the bottom of the bank. Flood zone is partway up the bank at elevation 12, but the slope in the bank continues up to 24 or 26 elevation running along here, because this slope is steeper than 4:1. So it goes up higher than the flood zone itself. So that really, you can tell when you're at the top of the bank along here. I can go back to this one. The existing septic system, the sewage pipe runs out the back to a tank and a pump chamber and is pumped up to a leaching pit. And I know there was a concern by the neighbor on the north side about this pit, if there'd be any disturbance to the property. And the way we have it called out is really just to fill it in place. I mean, it could be either remove it or fill it in place, but because it's over the property line somewhat, the best way to not cause any damage, you can just basically take the cover off, maybe cave it in a little bit, and then fill it with clean sand. Make sure it's all pumped out, and these two probably will just have to be filled or carefully decommissioned so that the coastal bank is not disturbed in this location. You see the septic system is only, the absorption system is only 66 feet or 56 feet from the salt marsh in this location. And this is the existing conditions then to go over. So the house, because it doesn't conform already to the front setbacks, cannot be put any closer to the road, to Somerset Road, but it's built right up to it. This red line I have along here is the outline. Down here is the outline of the existing house. I didn't draw it across the front, but it's the, this is the existing house, or it's as close to the street as possible, pulled back a little bit from the sides, and it's pulled back, it no longer reaches to the coastal bank in this location. So we have, rather than being right at the coastal bank, about at this point here, about 7 feet back, a little closer. This is an overhang, a 2 foot overhang, which is 5 feet back from the top of the bank. And what I've drawn this area, there'll be no more stone surface down in this location. I had this labeled as lawn, as you can see, but I was corrected that it should be not grass, but clover through this area where it's, you know, ground cover to walk on, but clover rather than the typical grass lawn. But this does, as you know, houses, you know, more rectangular, does come out in this corner and a tiny bit here, larger than the existing house. but this area will, and where the house used to be, will now be vegetated rather than stone or house surface. And I don't have a full planting plan, but this area, there's some non-native grasses, landscape grasses in this area here. Those will be taken out, and native shrubs, clethra, inkberry, and viburnum dentatum I've suggested. There's also a large area of English ivy so to the best as possible without doing any damage to what's to the native plants there, do what's possible to take the English ivy at least out of the trees and try to start pulling it off of the ground surface also, if that before it takes over more of the area, more of the native area. We do have a pervious patio in this location with some more dry laid, not mortared masonry, but some steps going down around, and again the lawn, rather the clover surface again, but filling in this corner with some inkberry in this location. There is one cedar tree proposed to be taken down, as we show in this location right here. There's a 10-inch cedar tree. There are 2 4-inch dead cedar trees in this location. Also a rhododendron down here to be removed. And this is some type of a tree. It looks like cedar, but it looks like a non-native type of tree. I'm not quite sure what this is. And this area here is just non-native landscape plants and a stone retaining wall in this location. We've taken down a cedar tree, of course, 3 Eastern red cedars to replace the one that's taken down in this location, and dry wells for the roof runoff. And I'll note that the leaching component of the septic system is, I have the distance labeled, but it's further from the further from the beach, further from the salt marsh, I should say. It's 84 feet from the salt marsh. It's 18 feet further from the salt marsh in this location than the leaching pit was over here, which is to be removed. So that is what we are proposing, and I will take this all down if you'd like, and we can, I'll take your questions.
Thank you, Tom. Drew?
I was going to put up the PowerPoint here and show you some images of the site. This, looking at the current existing home from the road. You've got the gravel driveway, cobble apron extends around the right side of the home as you're looking at it from the road again. Bottom left image here just shows that heavily landscaped area here on the right side of the home, again, facing from the road, right side, where you've got a lot of, you know, landscape timber ties, heavily tiered landscape area. And then going over to the bottom of the bank, where you can see rounding, this is that kind of tree. We couldn't quite identify what it was right here. It kind of looks like some form of cedar or crossbreed between a cedar and something else. We're not really sure. And then you've got the walking space rounding the corner here towards the backyard, where the back of the property where it faces out towards the coastal bank. And just a couple more pictures here. Top left here, looking back up at that heavily tiered landscaped reinforced area. Again, there's the tree, unidentified tree, ornamental most likely. Top right, looking at the existing deck coming out right to the top of the coastal bank here. So this is the section that will be drawn back and eliminated. And then you'll have, when I get to the image up here, up the stairs, is where the proposed patio and stairs will come around to this area here. So yeah, looking up at the lower left photo, you've got the stairway again, and up here to the left area, these two are dead cedars, and I'll have a better picture of those in the next slide. But this is the area where the patio and stairs will be coming around. Bottom right, that's the stake for the work limit, right at the top of the bank. And looking again, this is, if you're looking at the house from the road, this is the left-hand side of the house coming down towards the back. These are the two dead cedars, and this is the general area. Again, work limit where cedars and hickory will be planted. And then the bottom photo here, I'm sorry, top photo here again, there's the existing deck coming out. So this is the area where the stairway and patio are proposed. Work limit here. And then you've got top of bank right along here. So it's a tight, it's definitely a tight site. It's a very, very steep hill, and we'll go back to the, I think I have a plan here, so go to the proposed plan. So my biggest concern, I did meet with Tom on site to go over some things, just because it is a real tight, you know, tight up against the bank, pre-existing non-conforming structure. You've got a very, very steep bank here leading down to the wetland and then eventually Aquay Bay. So the primary concern here is, you know, the digging and the excavation for the house footprint and how that may or may not impact some of the roots that are on the bank. So I'll go back down to this. So here, this is the best photo really right here. So you've got these pitch pines right here that are, you know, easily 30, 40 plus feet tall, leaning right over the bank, and you're going to have excavation in this area. So it's something, well, if you approve the project, again, bottom left, just showing you, there's the work limit, there's the tree. So these trees could easily be impacted by the construction activity. And one thing that the only thing I can really suggest, because I know it, I understand it's a very tight working space to be in, is to require, you know, some form of compensatory mitigation if that situation arises. The other condition, situation, possibility is that, you know, the branches of these trees, when this house, you know, if it's approved, it gets reconstructed as proposed, you may have some issues with the existing limbs coming over any new structure here. It's always inevitable. It happens with almost every teardown rebuild in a tight spot like this. So again, the best way to deal with that situation, you know, if it involves so much pruning that it's going to kill the tree off, or if excavation for the house is going to sever the roots and kill the tree off, that we require, you know, enough mitigation to ensure the stability of this bank should those situations arise. So I did, you know, I had some input about drawing back the work limit originally from the plan that was originally presented during the on-site, and they did that So what you're seeing here is the latest iteration of that that plan, because the first one was really just way too close to the top of the bank and almost going over the bank. It was just for the work limit aspect of it, and that just wasn't acceptable. So understanding that it is a very, very tight site to work with, these are the best recommendations that I can come up with. So I'll hand it back to the commissioners.
Thank you, Drew. Questions and comments from the commissioners?
Drew, along that road on the water side against Aquay Bay, over the last, I'll say, several years, just about every house has been taken away, and they were old structures like this one. Was there any experience with other trees being damaged along that banking that you were cautioning us about?
Yes, it did happen. And it happened. There was one lot, I think it's a couple of lots down from this one, that was a fairly recent teardown rebuild where it wasn't, put it this way. The contractor went ahead and removed a tree and then told me afterwards, oh yeah, the roots were severed and it got damaged. So who knows if that's really the truth or not. It was a very large pitch pine. But I know, you know, generally speaking, when you're looking at the crown of a tree and you measure down vertically from that crown, that's usually the extent of the root mass. Generally speaking, not always in every case, but for pitch pines, they have a very shallow root mass. And so it generally coincides with the extent of the crown of the tree. So it's going to take, you know, some care and caution, some substantial, you know, siltation and erosion control in this area if you were to approve the project as presented. And we would just make it a point to be extra vigilant, you know, during construction with specific protocols on not just erosion control, but checks, maybe having the requirement of an on-site person to check on that above and beyond what we would do, which is a condition we have invoked in the past for projects that are right up against the resource area. So that could be something that we could also add in, you know, just during that phase of the construction, the actual excavation in that area, that there be someone there as a requirement to monitor that situation and make sure that, you know, it goes according to plan. So, but it's definitely a concern on this. It's right there. Top of the bank is just real, real close.
Thank you, Drew. Other questions? Any questions or comments from the public? Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion. This is a, oh, lost my agenda. Where'd it go?
Notice.
NOI. Thank you.
I would move we close an issue in regards to this with the condition that there be an independent monitor observing the excavation portion of the project.
Thank you, Brad. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Charlie. Voting, Brad.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Charlie.
Yes.
Paul.
Yes.
Alexandra.
Yes.
And I vote aye as well. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Good night, Tom. All right, now calling the 618 hearing for Mashpee Commons. This is at 476 and 483 Falmouth Road and 0 and 299 River Road. Proposed repair of failed earthen dam at end of Trout Pond. Owners of record, Mashpee Commons, LP, and trustees of reservations. Representative is Horsley Winton Group Incorporated. This is an NOI.
Am I up?
Hey,
yeah, you yes, are ma'am. Up.
Good evening.
If you wanted to screen share, Amy, I stopped.
You know, that's good because as soon as I heard you say that a few minutes ago, I scrambled and pulled some pictures together. good evening. For the record, Amy Ball from Horsley Winton Group. I'm the senior ecologist here. This evening, I have with me Jeff Glover, who is the design engineer for the project, as well as Tom Ferranti, who is the director of planning and construction for Mashpee Commons. The applicant, Buff Chase, was not able to join us. So the project, oh, I suppose I could start sharing, huh? Can you all see that?
Looking at your mail, though.
We see your mail.
I mean, my mail? Oh, goodness. Let's try that again. Goodness, I hope I haven't said anything bad. Stop sharing and start again.
I'm not losing my mind. Don't worry.
At least it's not televised.
I have been waiting all pandemic for a moment like that, and I thank you.
Is that any better?
It was benign. Perfect. It's okay.
That happened a long time ago.
So can you see the plans now?
Or are you still... Sheet one.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
There we go. Sorry about that. So just to give you a sense of what we're proposing here, it's a dam repair for the Trout Pond Dam. The Mashpee Rotary is here off to the left of the aerial photograph. Trout Pond is a long linear pond, and the dam itself is along an existing walking path at the northeast end of Trout Pond. You notice that the property is actually on four, the dam itself is actually on four different properties, two that are owned and under the care of Mashpee Commons and two that are owned by the Trustees of Reservations. So under existing conditions, you have Trout Pond itself. There is now a breach, and I'll show you a picture of this in a minute, within the, along the trail here. And a perennial stream downstream of the dam. There's an area of BVW, there's an area of Inland Bank, there's riverfront area covers the entire thing, the buffer zone covers the entire thing, and it's mapped by rare species from the natural heritage. It's a 5 scale, so that'll give you some sense of that. So the dam was breached sometime last fall. There were some emergency sandbags and some provisions to try and to stave that off. The path itself has been closed since then with this 1x10 or something going across it. And you can see that the pond levels, if you look at the upper edge in the right, upper right-hand corner of this photo, you can see the pond levels have dropped as one would expect with the dam breach. So the proposal is to restore this failed earthen dam similar to what had been done in the past, but with a number of important fail-safe provisions to make it more, have some greater longevity. The last time this failed was back in about 2004 when there was a, as you can see in the previous picture, there was an old corrugated pipe that got clogged and, the pond surge overwhelmed the area and you had a breach then. The proposal for this time around is to ensure that the new pipe that is going to be placed in this location doesn't get clogged, and that will involve a precast concrete overflow structure and a trash rack so that solid debris and floatables within the pond won't clog this, the outlet pipe, then cause that same condition to happen again. Other provisions that we're using in this, Jeff can go into some of these details, I'll just kind of give you the high level of it. Using a low permeable material within the restored dam so that it discourages water seeping through it, as well as an anti-seep collar within the area. And then finally, a scour protection of a stone pad at the down gradient end of things. There's also going to be an emergency overflow that'll help with like 100-year events so that the water from the pond or any runoff from the area will flow away from the existing weaker part of the dam, I suppose, and then discharge back into the wetlands down gradient without compromising the dam itself. The project, as I mentioned, is located in a number of overlapping resource areas and jurisdictional buffer zones. Most of the impacts that are proposed are temporary in nature, only that which is needed to repair the dam. The permanent structures, of course, would be the splash pad and the precast overflow structure, the trash rack. Those will remain to help protect the integrity of the dam. There's a staging area. If you look back, one more, up closer to Route 28, there's a road that comes off of 28 and another road that comes off of 28. And then there's sort of an intersection of these two areas. So staging can be placed further away from the resource areas during construction. And as far as that, the project proposes a limited project, so we did present some alternatives. We think this is the best approach for the time being. There have been some considerations for some future changes that may be aesthetic in nature, but this is designed to be long-lasting. In other words, we won't have to replace it in another few years. Disturbed services will be stabilized either with a retractable blanket or a seed mix. And I think with that, I'm gonna turn it back over to you. That was kind of a big picture. And if you have any questions, please let us know.
Thank you very much, Amy. Drew, comments?
So just to, just something that was brought up as myself, Alex and Paul were on site this week to check this out, as we just noted, a couple of structures that have been out there probably, you know, associated with prior repairs and damage, after failure. One of them is a large kind of metal rebar type structure just down gradient of that photo, Amy, that you have up. If you're facing downstream to your left, there's this kind of metal rebar frame.
Okay.
Thing. Maybe that was a trash catching or debris catching thing associated. I don't know.
Perhaps.
Yeah, it kind of looks like it. But and then an old rusty chair that.
That was in the other picture there.
Drew, I can actually speak to the rebar cage if you'd like. I don't know if you.
Yeah, sure.
It's important to you, but hi, I'm Tom Ferranti. I'm the director of planning and construction for Mashpee Commons, and you know, as Amy mentioned, there have been a couple other breaches. The first one was before my time. But in around 2004, there was another one. And we, at the time, we were seeing a lot of debris that was ending up in the pipe that was put in by the town during the first emergency repair. We found basketballs shoved in there. We found big rocks. We found dead turtles. I mean, we found a little bit of everything. And so at the time, we started to try and come up with some interim measures that could be put in place to prevent some of these large items from being sucked into the pipe, in the hope of continuing to allow water to flow through. So that rebar cage was actually one of the strategies that was put in place to try and stop the larger items from coming in. So okay, that was, yeah, that is something that was put in place. But you know, as I think Brian mentioned, you know, as long as we can do without any disturbance, we'll get it out of there now. This temporary repair would supplant that.
Sure. And my other question is just in related, because I know this was touched upon, and I don't, you know, want to get into a lot of detail at this point. I want to focus on what's being presented, but you know, some thoughts on long-term solutions out here, because I know this is certainly going to last much longer than previous attempts. That's for sure. I know that there was some discussion about really long-term possibilities out here. And again, you know, I'm not expecting a lot of detail, but just maybe touch upon that for the commissioner's sake.
I mean, I can certainly speak to that a little bit. Like I said, the design modifications over the previous, fixes are intended to be a nice long-term solution. Mm-hmm. My understanding, and Tom can correct me, is that if there were any other improvements to this area, because it is an existing walking path, that they would be more, aesthetic in nature.
Okay.
Yeah, and just to follow up on what Amy said, because we share this land with the trustees of reservations, it's an important connection in the town's trail network. And as we go through our master planning exercise here, connecting the rivers in the town of Mashpee, the Quashnet River and the Mashpee River, is an important piece of what we're looking at. So while there are sort of contemplations and considerations for how to incorporate this, you know, really for us, the next step is to start doing kind of an evaluation of the water quality and really the edge of the pond and the water level and things like that to figure out how it would best fit into an overall trail network and walking path system, really in this part of the town.
Right. And just to piggyback on that, Tom, this area was a prolific study site for brown bats. There were a lot of echolocation studies here. So this water body has a lot of environmental significance and history as an important habitat feature in this area. So it'd be good to see you guys working together with the trustees and trying to do what you can to improve this area. And I don't think I have any other comments in regards to the project itself. I think it's obviously, well, I know it's a net environmental benefit in this situation. Certainly go a long way towards improving the conditions out here. There was one issue where we're still awaiting natural heritage. The timelines for natural heritage letters and projects rarely meet up. Unfortunately, a natural heritage has 30 days to comment. So, you know, Amy and Horsley Witten, everybody understands that if they come forward with a letter that has certain conditions, those would be incorporated into the order. So they're aware of that in lieu of receipt of a letter at this point. If the commission's satisfied with that procedure, you can render a decision tonight in lieu of that letter, which will be forthcoming in the next couple of weeks, hopefully.
Drew, did you want me to stop sharing?
Yeah, you can stop sharing, Amy. That's fine.
Drew, Caitlin, I just have a quick question.
Yeah.
So will there be trail access as part of this project? Will people be able to walk over the structure as of now?
As of now, I believe that the trustees have marked these trails as closed.
They have.
On their website.
Well, I shouldn't have said as of now. I meant as of this project.
Oh, the purpose of this design is to create a structure that would allow the trail network to continue. So this is something that can be walked over in its temporary permanent situation. It is something that's passable.
Very good. Thank you.
Other questions? Is there anyone calling in from the public who'd like to make commentary?
They would be on the line already, so.
All right. Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion on this.
Oh. I have a question.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Ann Malone. I'm at 14 Red Cedar Road. I'm just wondering if you can give us a sense, those of us who use this trail network, what the timeline for the project might be.
Tom, do you want to?
Oh, yeah, sorry. I didn't want to jump in and step on anyone's toes. You know, as Drew mentioned, you know, we're still waiting on some information back from Natural Heritage, and we would need to
understood
to come in. But, you know, our goal is to try and get this accomplished as quickly as possible. You know, we've started to have some conversations with both with Horsley Witten and with some prospective contractors, and really looking at getting through the rainiest part of our season in an attempt to try and do it when we might be entering into a drier season, so that we have less of a risk of a heavy downpour coming. You know, there are certain measures that are designed to be put in place for erosion control during the process, but if we can limit what that erosion might be with limiting when we do it for rain, then it's better.
Well, since Cape Cod is a pretty rainy place year round, I wonder if you could attach some months to that timing.
I think really what we've sort of been told is, you know, if we can get into sort of the end of June, beginning of July, that's really the time frame that they're telling us would be the best to approach it.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful to hear. And
yeah, we would look for input from, I mean, certainly if the commission has any, you know, any sort of recommendations or suggestions about when they would like to see it, we would certainly factor that into our process as well.
All right, thank you very much. Anyone else on the line from the public? All right, hearing none. If there's no other questions, I'll entertain a motion. This is NOI.
I would move that we close an issue in regards to the item from Mashpee Commons LP 476 to 483 Falmouth Road and 0 to 299 River Road.
Thank you, Brad. Second. Do I hear a second? Thank you, second. Charlie. Voting, Brad.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Charlie.
Yes.
Paul.
Yes.
Alexandra.
Yes.
I vote aye as well. Motion carries.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
You too. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.
You too. Thank you.
Thank you. Looks like we have an extension on the agenda.
Yeah, the last two items, there were three. Two certificate of compliance inspections, both passed, and then the extension request is just due to a lack of getting started on that particular project, but not only their first extension request, so no reason to not grant it.
All right, so on the 6/21 hearing, Stuart Leslie, Frank, 22 Little Neck Road, three-year extension of order of conditions, representative of Cape and Islands Engineering. I assume there's, is Matt still here? Or?
There's no reason to go over any of those last three. They're just rubber stamps.
All right. Do we need to take a vote on the extension?
Nope.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Turn it back over to Drew for the pre and post meeting items.
Okay, first, and I'm going to call on Paul again, our minute master, to tell me if you have that, Paul. I don't know if you do.
I am not the minute master tonight. I do not have that.
Okay, I don't know who was in attendance.
Sorry.
But we can, no problem. We can table that for the next meeting. So I'll just go over some of the pre-post items. Unless, Caitlin, do you know who was present at the April 22nd meeting? Oh, she's muted anyway. All right, we'll table it for the next meeting.
Sorry.
No problem. Childs River Restoration, again, just continuing on in the Falmouth portion of that project, and they're moving along at the same pace they did in Mashpee, so everything is going very smoothly. And if anyone hasn't been out to the Mashpee Garner Bog side yet at the Childs River Conservation Land, I highly recommend going out there around this time of year because this is where you're going to see a lot of the emergent vegetation starting to take foothold in that area. So you'll get a picture of what it's going to look like when all of that vegetation comes in. And we'll be happy to meet anybody out there who wants to do a little field trip and get us out of the office at the same time. So please feel free. Redbrook Road Culvert, the Town of Mashpee through Catherine Laurent and with the assistance of Betsy Gladfelter out of Falmouth. She's with the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, and she's been just a tremendous help in getting us this application together through the Division of Ecological Restoration to get funding for the repair of the culvert and then looking at future restoration of this flooded bog situation and eventual restoration into a brook habitat. That's still a ways off, but the application has been submitted, and with Betsy's help, I think it's going to be a really competitive application, and hopefully we'll qualify for this year's priority project funding through DER. A lot of people have been calling in, obviously, to complain about that drained bog. A lot of people were under the impression that we had, either us or Falmouth, had gone out and pulled sandbags or pulled boards and caused this bog to leach out bog water, and that wasn't the case. It was really, it clogged up naturally. Debris must have just caught and it stopped leaking for a period, and then it filled back up, and then whatever clogged broke loose and it went back down again. So that just caused a whole new wave of people calling in saying, why did you remove boards? Why did you take the sandbags out? We didn't do any of that. We just witnessed the same thing they did, which just happened on its own for whatever reason. We're trying to do what we can to expedite trying to find out what the issue is, because you know this is something that could impact the integrity of the road, and you really want to get on that sooner than later. So something may even happen before we, you know, get grant funding, maybe emergency funds or something like that. But something needs to be done sooner than later, because this is a major road. You know, it's used a lot. It's at a very low elevation. It's almost always semi-flooded throughout the year. And so it's definitely a situation that safety is paramount. So we'll continue to keep everybody updated as we go through this. Bylaw review subcommittee. Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped one there. Upper Quashnet restoration. They're almost finished with the data collection out there. And once they're done with that, then we'll see that conceptual plan, and they'll attend one of our meetings, Neil Price from Horsley Witten, and show us what they've got, the data they've collected, and what they're recommending as far as the beginnings of a conceptual approach for restoration out there. So that should be happening probably right around mid-summer, end of July, I'm guessing, and we'll continue to keep everybody updated. But more progress out there. They're really ramping up with the data collection, and we should be hearing some more information soon. And bylaw review subcommittee, we're kind of in a holding pattern, if you will. That measure obviously has been postponed indefinitely, so we may not need to discuss it at all. Chad, I hope you're right that they found another parcel. I'm just, you know, keeping this agenda item on just in case something happens.
Oh, we have in writing that they promised a another engineering solution in exchange for my support of the project. So I'd like to hold them to that.
I certainly hope so. We'll see what happens. I didn't want to take this off the agenda yet until we get absolute confirmation. So we'll stay there. Bylaw review subcommittee. I'm sorry, that was the sewer substation. I mistakenly called that the bylaw. Reviews the bylaw review subcommittee. We're wrapping up some final edits to what myself, Paul, and Brian have been looking at as far as editing. And Brad, I think Brad, were you on the?
I think I was.
You think you were? Yeah.
Well, I was many times in the past, so probably you were. I was probably drafted this time too.
So we're just waiting on one input from town council on mitigation for docks and piers, repairs of docks and piers, amendments to docks and piers, or new docks and piers. And that would come in the form of a monetary donation, if you will, or monetary mitigation to our shellfish propagation program. And it's based on a formula that the town of Dennis uses and a couple other towns on Cape Cod, based on the overall square footage of pile impact within shellfish habitat associated with any given fixed pier. So we've sent that off to town council to take a look at, and we just want to make sure whether that can be done as a regulatory change, or if we have to amend the bylaw, which would require going before town meeting, putting it in the town meeting warrant, and then going up the chain through state legislature and governor's signature. Which it very well may end up being the case, but we'll have town council vet that out for us. And some sad news to report that the rock of our department, the cog in the wheel, Cynthia, is departing our town hall on May 18th. Again, yeah. Oh, this time it's for real.
When did May 18th. You say?
May 18th.
Oh, yeah. My goodness. That's not enough notice.
No, it was 2 weeks from when she initially gave it. I just didn't want to announce anything without her blessing. So, as she said, it was, you know, fine to bring it up at tonight's meeting. And obviously, you know, We're going to miss her tremendously and everything. She's one of the greatest employees I've ever worked with in any job I've ever had. And she's just been a joy to work with. She's always got a permanent smile on her face and just the best attitude every single day. So to say we're going to miss her is really the biggest understatement of the century. And we can only hope that her replacement comes close to what she brought to the table. But we wish Cynthia well, and we will have a small get together at Town Hall. Unfortunately, I can't invite anybody inside Town Hall because nobody's allowed inside Town Hall. So maybe we'll, at some point when COVID is a thing of the past, we can have some sort of gathering with Cynthia and just recognition of all she's done for our department over the years and just her tremendous presence and personality overall. So just wanted to let everybody know so that when you call after Tuesday, you won't be hearing her pleasant voice over the phone anymore. It'll be the rude voice of myself or Caitlin.
Caitlin's not rude.
She's never rude.
Just me.
I'll do my best to fill her shoes.
I think we've established who's rude in that office.
Guilty.
So, I just wanted to say that I echo all of Drew's sentiments about Cynthia, that she has been nothing but wonderful, and she's been training us the best she can. So be patient, and we will do everything we can to replace somebody who's basically irreplaceable.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, we will be, that's a good point, Caitlin, because we will be assuming just a very significant workload in Cynthia's absence and processing permits and dealing, you know, with the administrative duties. So if we don't pick up the phone right away or we don't answer an email right away, you'll understand why over the next month or so, hopefully sooner, that we're just really going to be inundated with, you know, our day-to-day office duties in addition to everything else. So we hope the town will be able to find a qualified candidate as soon as possible, but given, you know, the timeline of everything, it's going to be at least a month that we'll be, you know, kind of in the weeds, so to speak, with the administrative duties. But I have the utmost confidence in Caitlin and myself to continue along. We just might not answer phone calls the same day as they're received or emails. Last item is I have pictures from face pics from Chad, Paul, and Brad for picture IDs. So Charlie and Tom and Alex, if you guys want an ID, it'd be easiest to get them all done at once. So when you get a chance, send me a face pic. If you're interested, if not, not a problem. It's entirely up to you. But just send me a face picture because it'd be a lot easier for Deputy Phelan to do all this at once. Instead of breaking it up over time. So, you know, either tomorrow, early next week, maybe like Tuesday or Wednesday at the latest, try to get that to me and I'll submit what I have and get your ID cards made. And they will have your expiration dates on each card. So they'll have to get changed every 2 years. And just in case anybody isn't aware, when you come up for the end of your term, the way we do it in Mashpee is you're automatically renewed without any kind of fanfare or, you know, process. So it's up to you to tell us that if you're no longer interested in serving on the commission or you want to change from full-time to associate or something like that, just know that it's an automatic process. So you're the one that has to let us know about that, you know, when your term comes up. So, and that's all I have.
Thank you, Drew.
Hey, any Drew, Drew, I found those minutes on my computer if you want to back up.
Yeah, sure. That'd be great.
Oh, okay. Sweet. This meeting didn't go
well. Oh, Chad, you're almost out, Chad.
We got dogs.
Okay,
that need to be
present
walked,
at
that
we,
meeting were.
Yeah, we do.
present at the meeting were Chad Smith, Brian Whedon, Brad Sweet, Paul Colombo, Tom O'Neill, Charles Dalton.
Perfect. We have a quorum.
What's the date?
So the date is April
22nd. Mr. Chairman, I would make a...
No, sorry. Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead, Paul.
I would make a motion that we accept the minutes as presented for April 22nd, 2021.
Second.
Beautiful. Thank you, Paul, and whoever seconded them. There's no way I'm going to remember who actually was at the meeting, but I remember I was. So, Brad, were you there?
Yes, I seconded it.
Beautiful. Voting. Brad?
Yes.
How about Tom? Were you there?
Yes, I was.
He was there.
Aye.
Charlie?
Yes.
Paul?
Yes. That's it.
And yourself, Chad. Very good.
Vote aye as well. Motion carries.
All right. That's it.
All right.
One last thing off the list.
Thank you. Enthusiastically entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'm moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All right.
Oh, yes, no. Second.
Those are like 4 seconds right there. I'm glad we're all in agreement. Voting, Brad.
Yes.
Alexander.
Yes.
Tom.
Aye.
Charlie.
Yes.
Paul.
Yes.
I vote aye as well. Motion carries.
Have a great night, everybody.
Meeting's adjourned.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Okay.